On completion of this chapter, you will have an understanding of who issues a loading order and the implications of a loading order, the implications of a loading order, the load on top or lot procedure, the difference between a loading and a voyage order, the purpose of a pre-arrival meeting, who is responsible for making the loading plan, the contents of a loading plan, who must be familiar with the loading plan, the purpose of the checklist, the procedure if any negative answers appear in the checklist, for instance malfunction of important equipment for the safe operation of the vessel, who is to carry out the various tasks required by the checklist. Who issues the loading order? The loading order is normally communicated to the vessel's master by email from the owner or operator or charterers. Why are the implications of receiving an early loading order more important for chemical, product and gas carriers than for crude oil tankers? The loading order is the basic information needed in order to prepare the vessel for loading. The loading order may vary depending on several factors. For example, the ship is trading worldwide in the spot market, trading worldwide on a time charter party, or trading as a shuttle tanker on time charter in a fixed area, etc. Requirements for the notification of notice of readiness, lay time, etc. may vary. For crude oil carriers, the practical implications of receiving an early loading order rather than a late are less important compared with chemical, product and gas carriers. Crude oil tankers do not have to prepare the tanks, like water washing, gas freeing and inspecting the tanks for cleanliness, re-inerting or cooling down the tanks, etc., prior to loading the next cargo. In which event can the ship owner lose money because of not having all cargo tanks empty on arrival? When a crude oil tanker has carried out cargo tank cleaning during the ballast voyage, there will be slops and residues collected and stored in one slop tank. If there is any doubt about retaining the slops, the master must communicate this question to the owners and cargo owner or charterers and request their advice. Most charter parties provide for the charterer to make the decision regarding the disposition of slops. If the characteristic of the slop oil and the nature of the next cargo permit, the slops may be retained on board and the next cargo loaded on top of them. This is normally done with crude oil cargoes when the same or similar crude will be carried on the next voyage. The charterer may wish to load on top, or lot, in which case full freight will be normally paid. Charterers may require the slops to be discharged. The time required to do this normally constitutes lay time used. If the charterer does not wish to load on top, the slops must be segregated and freight will not be paid to the ship owner on the space or deadweight used. What is the main purpose of the pre-arrival meeting conducted by the master? A pre-arrival meeting is performed in different ways, depending on the vessel's trade. The master normally conducts the meeting, and the main purpose of the meeting is to ensure that all officers and crew are acquainted with the time schedule and activities expected to take place during the port call. Through this time schedule framework, the risk assessments associated with each in-port activity and the ship's plan for mitigating each of those risks is communicated. The contingency plan, which is the result of risk assessments, should be highlighted in the meeting. Besides the main purpose of a port call, loading or discharging, other activities can be STS lightering, special security measurements, crew change, stores and provisions, bunkering, external technical service for the vessel's equipment, various external inspections, etc. In addition, crude oil carriers are frequently involved in ship-to-ship, STS, transfer operations, either for loading or discharge. STS operations are labour-demanding, and because of their nature, subject to special MARPOL regulations. who is responsible for making the loading plan. As soon as the loading order is received, the chief officer, who is responsible for making the loading plan, starts to pre-plan and work out a preliminary loading plan. What does the loading plan consist of? The loading plan is a comprehensive and detailed schedule that comprises a time bar, which begins at the start of the planned loading and describes the precise steps to be taken. Which cargo tanks to start loading in, the tank ullages at which to stop and change over to other tanks, and which ballast tanks to deballast from in a sequence of stages until the completion of the operation. The ship's draft fore and aft and the shearing force and bending moments on the hull when each stage is reached are calculated in advance using the loading computer and shown on the loading plan time bar. These calculated drafts and stresses ensure that the ship's hull remains within the permissible limits as prescribed in the class-approved loading manual. Throughout the operation, the indicated tank ullages help junior officers and the pumpman to know when a certain stage of the loading is reached and the next steps should be taken. Comparing visual drafts with those shown in the plan helps the officers in ensuring that the loading is going safely according to the plan. The plan also shows cargo specifications and a tank diagram spreadsheet with details on cargo grades, quantity, and their distribution into different cargo tanks. Further, the plan details line and valve systems to be used and loading rates, starting rate, full rate, and topping off rate, as well as the deballasting schedule. The chief officer conducts a meeting with the junior officers, such as the second and third officer, pumpman, and bosun, in due time prior to arrival. The purpose of this meeting is to have their acknowledgement of full understanding of the loading plan. Who must be familiar with the loading plan? The second and third officer are responsible duty deck officers during loading, and consequently need to be fully familiar with the vessel's cargo system. To assist them during the operation, they have the pumpman, who is a qualified technician and responsible for maintaining the cargo equipment. In addition, they have the bosun, who is the leader of the deck crew. The loading plan made out by the chief officer prior to arrival must be considered as a preliminary plan, which cannot be completed until after the ship shore meeting. What is the purpose of the pre-arrival checklist? Since the introduction and implementation of the International Safety Management Code, or ISM code, mandatory from 1998, ship owners or other companies responsible for operation of ships have had to develop and implement safety management systems, both for the ships and shore-based organization. The safety management objectives of the company should provide for safe practices in ship operation and systems to monitor and document onboard activities where needed. Checklists to document safe practices and compliances with rules and regulations, as well as the company's policy, have been developed and implemented as industry standard in connection with various operations on board. What should the ship's procedure aim for if negative answers are found for certain items in the checklist? The checklist must be completed in ample time prior to arrival in order to allow for repairs of malfunctioning equipment or call for external service upon arrival. Any negative answers in the checklist must be reported to the owner or operator in order to make a common effort to ensure the vessel's safe and efficient port call without any delays. Who carries out the tasks? The pre-arrival checklist is a comprehensive record of preparations carried out in order to document that the vessel is arriving in a condition according to the company's policy and international rules and regulations. All junior officers, including the pumpman and bosun, as well as the engine officers and crew, will be engaged in testing and checks in order to complete the pre-arrival checklist. In the engine, all the technical systems required by the checklist are to be tested, and the result reported back to the chief officer. These tests must include operation of the cargo and inert gas pipelines valve operating systems, hydraulic power packs or boilers for cargo pumps, inert gas systems, ballast and stripping pumps, and alarms and trips of all these. The junior deck officers are responsible for checking their designated equipment and systems, such as firefighting and life-saving equipment, navigational instrumentation, etc. The pumpman is responsible for function checking of all cargo-related safety systems and equipment. The bosun with the deck crew must check and prepare all mooring equipment, oil pollution prevention equipment, accommodation ladders, pilot ladders, hose handling cranes and deck scuppers, and assist the pumpman with preparation of the cargo manifolds to be used.